Welcome to Leith Live series of podcasts. These are memories and stories from people who lived, worked or went to school in Leith. Today Miles is talking to Gordon Munro, the Labour Councillor for Leith. Gordon has had a love of music from a very early age. In fact, his parents said he could play the record player before he could walk. We'll be hearing some of Gordon's own records from his diverse collection, from Lily the Pink by the Scaffold to Free Nelson Mandela by the Specials. Gordon will tell us of some of the gigs he's attended over the years and how he discovered punk when he saw the Damned play the first ever punk gig at Clouds in Edinburgh, and he knew that this was his music.
And it's a warm welcome to Thelma FM. We are the broadcasting arm of the Living Memory Association, and today I'm delighted to be joined in the studio by Gordon Munro.
Good morning.
And Gordon, of course, is the councillor for Leith, Labour councillor for Leith, and we're going to be going through some of your records today, Gordon.
Yeah, I've brought along a handful of records. I've actually got 300 albums and about the same in singles back home. But wow. So I just selected a handful.
Brilliant. Well, we've got some good selection here. We're going to start off, though, with one of our collections, and this is the good old Eartha Kitt, and this is one of my favourites. Say Seymour.
Bras dessous, en chantant des chansons, c'est si bon de se dire des mots doux, de petits rien dis-tu, mais qui en disent en langue, en voyant notre mine ravie, les passants dans la rue. Nous envieux, c'est si bon de guetter dans ses yeux une esprit merveilleux qui donnait le frisson. C'est si bon.
We were talking about Eartha Kitt. You remember Eartha Kitt being on the television?
Yeah. I remember Mum and Dad watching her when she was on some of the variety shows. But for me, where she made the biggest impact was as Catwoman in Batman.
Of course, yeah. I mean, and I always think that's, it wasn't too many years before that Nat King Cole had his kind of show cancelled because they couldn't actually sell it in the Deep South. And yeah. Then you have this amazing thing that Eartha Kitt takes over as Catwoman from a white woman to be.
That's right. And she was sensational, and she played it for real as well, you know, with it.
Yeah. Oh God. Yeah. I mean, absolutely. And I hadn't appreciated when I was younger about all this civil rights and great champion for LGBT. Rights.
I suppose in one way we were quite lucky. We just accepted it for what it was, yeah. Rather than actually contested it.
Yeah,
you know.
Absolutely.
And I think that's a good sign of progress as well. You know.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, on from Eartha, Gordon, you were born in Leith.
Yeah, Bridge Street. No longer here with us. And not even a plaque.
No, it's terrible. And we'll be putting them up on Facebook. We've got some great photos from your childhood. And there's this great one, if anyone wants to look there, of you on the flat roof of Bridge Street tenement.
Yeah, that's where, that was the drying green. That's where my mum used to hang the washer. You'll see little me running towards, it must be my dad doing the camera because he never let mum have a shot at it, really.
So what number Bridge Street was that?
14.
14.
It was my granny's house. It was my mum's house.
Oh, right.
And they moved, because my granddad was looking for work, so they moved down to Slough. Mum and dad got their house because I'd come along, and then my sister came along as well. So,
right.
But it was one of these old-fashioned tenements where communal toilet on the landing. And we moved out to a brand-new council house out at Drumbray,
all
or
right.
Clermiston. With luxuries like an indoor toilet, you know. I know.
And, again,
and our own bedroom as well,
wow,
for me and my sister.
That's something. We've got photos we put up on Facebook. And as you see from the photos, still are very much in development out there.
Yeah. They'd still move up the hill to, you know, the top of the road. You know, there was only the main Drumbray where the number one bus goes,
yeah.
And still goes.
yeah, indeed. We're going to be talking, we've got four or five records of yours here, all singles.
Yeah.
What was the first record you bought yourself?
Oh, the first record was Lily the Pink, The Scaffold, and I loved it. You know,
remember it well, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, because I used to remember, you used to see people like that, and there was a kids' programme, and I don't know how they got away with it, called Do Not Adjust Your TV Set, but, the first lot of the Pythons and that came through that programme, and it was really quite anarchic.
Yeah.
I loved it for that reason.
Yeah, I remember, because it's Roger McGough, isn't it? He's in...
Yeah, Scaffold. That's right, The Scaffold, yeah.
Paul McCartney's brother, is that?
Yeah, Mike McCartney, yeah.
Yeah.
Aye,
so,
aye.
I vividly remember that. And so as a family, did you have lots of music records in the house?
Yeah, we had a radiogram, one of the old-fashioned ones, kind of like you've got a replica through there in the main room, where it was both a radiogram and a record player, and... My mum and dad were never short of telling me that I could actually play the record player before I could walk, you know.
So it was in your blood?
Yeah, definitely. Although I wasn't as careful with the records then as a bairn as I am now, looking after them and making sure you hold them on the outside and not put your thumbs on the... But one of the few regrets I have in life is that I, not meaningly, but broke my dad's Elvis 78s.
Ooh. God, that's
what made it even more painful is that how much is that puppy in the window survived? And I played it relentlessly.
Oh, they must have been quite tolerant, your parents.
They must have been.
So we're going to move on. We're going to go to your first record that you brought in, and that's Dr Feelgood. Why? Tell us about
that. Because I seen them at Leith Town Hall in 1975, and they were sensational. And they were just such a difference to all the prog rock nonsense that was happening at the time, you know. I mean, you couldn't get further away from Tales from Topographic Oceans than Dr Feelgood.
Yeah, the prog rock did tend to go on a long time, didn't it? And in length of a track.
Yeah. And I think it was associated with a certain lifestyle, and that definitely wasn't what the young me was looking for.
Well, this is definitely much more. So this is, which track? Ooh, which track is this, Gordon? Back in the Night, which is, as you say, far away from prog rock. So you said you saw them at Leith Town Hall.
Yeah. Wilco Johnson was just absolutely sensational. Every time he did the guitar break, he was going haywiring right across the Leith Theatre stage and all that, and the crowd were going mental, you know. It was just transformative, you know. It was one of these gigs, and they were one of the bands that sort of were the bridge between, and the precursors to punk as well.
Yeah.
You know, because they took R&B and just ramped it up a wee bit, you know.
So at some point, you obviously started going to live gigs.
Yeah.
How old were you when you started to...
Well, because we didn't have money, my very first gig was when I was scuffing about school in fifth year. And one of the guys that we used to play football with had his arithmetic O-level the next again day, and therefore couldn't use his ticket to go and see Genesis. So my first gig was Genesis doing the Lamb Lies Down on Broadway tour.
Wow.
With Peter Gabriel still frontman.
I was going to say, this is the before Genesis of Phil Collins taking over.
Yeah, that's right. Aye. And I still remember it because it was great theatre. I mean, he had this a range of costumes, you know, and I still remember the encore where he was doing the knife and they were using the strobe lights and he was using the mic stand as if he was stabbing the audience. It was sensational.
Oh.
You just turn it right round and it's Eden, and he's really going for it. But it was a fantastic gig to go to.
Yeah.
You know, but also it also meant that, you know, when you were going to other things, you know, they really had to put on a show.
And I mean, with gigs you were going to, you said you're short of money. Were they expensive?
Yeah. I mean, for us, I mean, because it didn't have much money. I mean, I started working in 75, so that's how I could start, and that's how I used the money that I was getting from work, you know, because at that time, the reason I could afford it was that I was doing part-time shelf stacking at Asda in Milton Road, so that's how I could get the money together to go to that gig. And then I went to a few others. The one that I really remember that year in 75 was actually the sensational Alex Harvey Band Christmas show at the Apollo. And it was just brilliant. Yeah, it was just before all these things sort of changed and all. Got tickets in October that year because Bowie had announced that he was coming back to Wembley. So that was the Isolar tour, station to station. It was fantastic. There was no support band. Again, real theatre there as well. And he had the Dali Buñuel film in Sin Andalou. And because it's a silent film, he used Kraftwerk as the backing music for it, you know. Really worked. And then when the film finished, the screen went up and the band started launching into the band were there, just bright white light. And they, it was the station to station rift. And of course, they cranked it until Bowie himself came on and the place just erupted, you know. But one of the gigs, you know, for me, one of the gigs.
I was going to say, these are highly, you know, sought after and memories, aren't they, for you now?
But yeah. It was just before punk really sort of happened. You could see the cusp of it, because I can still remember seeing some folk dressed up and thinking, whoa, they look different, you know. And I reckon it was probably the Bromley contingent at the bottom of Wembley Way, you know.
All right.
And I just thought, you know, because they looked very cabaret extra-ish, you know. But yeah. But I was lucky because, seeing The Who at Parkhead that summer and The Stones at Nebworth as well. And that gig went on for ages because Lynyrd Skynyrd blew the whole amp set, so they had to get that replaced. You know, that was, again, phenomenal gigs.
These are huge artists and huge gigs, but then you must have been going to smaller ones as well.
Well, there was various pubs in that used to do stuff, you know. You go to the Yellow Carvel, which is now the Trom pub, you know.
Right.
Nicky Tam's in Victoria Street was always good. And, you know, they didn't charge, so you were going in to see bands, because there was a band that used to play there on Nicky Tam's on a Thursday night, and I loved going because they used to always finish with Southern Man, Young song.
Yeah.
So it was just, it was great. But the drink was dear, though. You know, a pint of lager and lime was 17 and a half pence. Shocking, I know. Shocking. I can see you're appalled.
I remember starting to drink and these concoctions, which I suppose they now call Alco-Pops.
Uh-huh.
But do you ever remember something called a black Chinese snake bite?
No.
Lager and lime's quite straightforward.
Yeah.
This was lager, cider and blackcurrant.
Aye. Oh, that's not a drink.
My
great uncle used to drink drinks like that, but he was called the minesweeper in the central bar because he used to put everybody's dregs into the glass and then neck it.
Oh,
I know, oh, vile,
God,
vile.
Oh, dear, oh, dear. So we're moving away from the big bands, and we've got the Valves here, Robot Love.
Robot Love. Yeah. Alice and I first met at a Valves gig at the West End Club on Princess Street. You know, we went to see them when they reformed, and their duty, I was speaking in a conversation with the drummer and Dave Carson on Leith Links at Gala Day. And Gordon was saying that they're hoping to get the album out. He says they were just working on the sleeve. So it's only taken 40 years for them to get the album out.
Well, late maturers, I think, is what the term is. Anyway, this is The Valves.
I'm in love with a robot girl. She's stepped out of another world. She stepped out of a big crown door.
You are listening to Thelma FM. We are the broadcasting arm of the Living Memory Association. We're chatting with Gordon today, going through some of his records and about his upbringing, his childhood. And we're now into going to gigs. You were telling me an interesting bit about the Valves there and some little...
Alison and I met and we played a gig at the West End Club, which became Fire Ireland in the early 80s. But I remember it was the first place I seen the Rizzillos at as well. They were a house band on a Saturday night there. We met because nobody was dancing to the band. So what I did was, first of all, I went and picked up Alison by the hips and got her pogo in, and then I did it with her pal, you know, and we all started jumping about to them, you know.
Brilliant.
Yeah, so, but as you can tell from the music, that was the kind of band they were in awe.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, yeah. And you were telling me an interesting bit about poetry and Broomhouse and...
Yeah, yeah, the lead singer, D. Robert, the last time I seen him after the Valves had sort of gone away, he was actually one of the support acts for Dixie's Midnight Runners at Usher Hall gig when they were doing the Tour IA tour. And he had this fantastic poem about packs of dogs running wild in Sight Hill and in Broomhouse, you know. And I can still remember seeing about 18, 20 of them, and they just go hearing across the football pitch, which is where the tram stop is now,
yeah,
the government buildings at Broomhouse. You'd see them every day, and you just wonder, where the hell are they coming from,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
I mean, whose dogs are they, you know? And I don't think they were anybody's. They were just running wild.
God, this feral pack of dogs.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But I mean, according to rumours, they were actually friendlier than the people in Broomhouse.
Anyone in Broomhouse, that is, of course, it's just a joke, so don't worry. And I see here we got Skids next.
Yeah, yeah. I remember seeing them rocking against racism in the bus depot. It was one of the places, because punk kind of, the town council, of which I'm a member now, in their wisdom, deemed that punk rock was not good enough for their citizens and was too dangerous.
Really?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So I still remember the council pulling a gig by Generation X at Clouds. So the promoters then had to get us all on buses out to East Linton. But we were drinking in what's now the Exotic Dancers Triangle at Westport. Yeah, but at that time it was the Burke and Hare. And I still remember coming out there, and then there was these guys that came out the pub that was across the road, sort of a disco place type thing underneath where the old GPO office used to be, Tower. Mm. And they said, oh, punks, let's go for them. And I managed to negotiate with one of their guys and said, look, send your people back. We're just gone down to the Clouds anyway, so we'll be away in a couple of minutes. And he said, right, aye, I'll do that, pal.
Right.
But one of the guys that was with us, Henry, who was straight, wasn't drinking, didn't like drinking that, was so disgusted at their behaviour that he set fire to his shirt. I know, fantastic.
So he wasn't drunk, but he set light to his shirt.
Yeah, yeah, because he wanted to show solidarity with us, you know, because we were getting picked on for the way we were dressed.
Wow, that's some statement, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. And nine of us piled into the car and went down to East Linton. And because they thought the gig might get pulled down there, Gen X went on first. And then the support band, who became Simple Minds,
right,
went on after them, you know.
That is rock and roll, well, not rock and roll, but history, isn't it?
Pop, yeah,
history.
Absolutely, absolutely.
I'm talking of pop history, this wonderful white 45 of the Skids, TV stars we're having, aren't we?
Yeah.
Is white, and it's virgin. Actually, I just realised that a white record is quite difficult to line up, but here we go, the Skids.
Yes. We may also speak politics to you today. All I can say is, I'm a child of a fucking father.
That was utterly brilliant. I didn't realise that Albert Tatlock was a punk, almost a punk chant.
Yeah, absolutely. It was always a favourite with the fans because it named people for Coronation Street, Crossroads, Kenny Dalglish, John Peel.
Yeah.
It was all people, Leonard Rossiter, you know, fantastic stuff.
And it's so much of the time, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
Done with a real tongue-in-cheek kind of
aye, absolutely. And then even just that wee guitar bit at the end there, you can see what became big country there with Stuart Adamson doing, you know, the wee bit of guitar at the end there.
Yeah,
you absolutely. Can see where he got the idea, the wee kernel for big country, you
yeah,
know?
Yeah, which I have to say is very seminal. When I was working in London back in the mid-80s, I had big country on a cassette, you know, this mm-hmm. is on a Sony, well, it wasn't a Sony Walkman, it was a Sanyo Walkman, listening to this. I hadn't even been to Scotland at that uh-huh. point, but thinking, I want to be in Scotland. So,
yeah.
Brilliant. So, Skids, I mean, again, a real central to that movement at the time, wasn't it?
Yeah, yeah. They were young. I mean, that was the thing about them, you know, was just that they were people the same age as you, and they were getting up there and just doing it, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, Ricky Jobson is, you know, younger, and Stuart Adamson, who's no longer with us, you know, was the same age as me. But we were all at that sort of first punk gig ever in Edinburgh, which was the Damned playing at Clouds. And that was it for me, you know. I was sold, you know. I knew that this was what I wanted to, you know, this was my music, you know, and it just blew all the hippie nonsense out the water.
Yeah.
You know, and exposed it for the indulgence that it was as well.
And I mean, we were talking between records and trying not to be nostalgic and old about this, but there's a vitalness, isn't there, to this punk music and the movements around it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, it was actually news from the front line, you know. If you heard the lyrics of The Clash, you know, or, I mean, even The Pistols as well, you know. I mean, you know, there was an edge and a dangerousness to what they were doing, but it was almost like reportage from the front line. And I think that it was unique what happened there, you know, because there was a whole bunch of people that burst through that it just wouldn't have happened the way that music was, because it had been incorporated. And this was something that came through the shop floor and reflected what was happening on the shop floor as well.
And it was particularly, I'm thinking of the Sex Pistols, when they infamously used the four-letter word on television, being goaded to use the four-letter word. And, of course, they would supply it, which was...
Yeah. They, I mean, well, not only that, but they'd actually got them tanked up in the green room before it, you know, so it really didn't take much more, you know, to do it. But I always felt that, you know, some of the stuff that they did, I mean, one of the records I've got back home is actually the Anarchy in the UK, but on the EMI label, you know, before they got chucked off it. I got that out of Woolies at the Kirgit, you know, because they had it in their remainder box, because they were actually, by that time, they were actually withdrawing it because they'd left the label, you know.
Great. I remember seeing, can't mention the name of the film, but I remember seeing the film, Sex Pistols film, probably late 70s, but I remember buying a trench coat, because one of them was wearing a trench coat.
Steve Jones, and it's the great rock and roll swindle you're talking about.
Yeah. So that is punk. We're going to be moving on to your last record for today, which is getting more political again, I suppose, isn't it?
Yeah, well, one of the groups that burst through was the Specials, and again, the Specials did that reportage from the front line as well. You know, I mean, everybody can remember Ghost Town, you know, because it just seemed to be a commentary on Britain at the time. But the Specials were actually one of the things that punk allowed to happen, was is that, you know, they came through, and then people like The Clash took them on tour with them, you know, to actually say, listen to these people, you know, they've got something to say. And again, at the time, because of the National Front being on the go, you know, a mixed-race band, which the Specials were, was actually a very, very strong message, you know, and especially for places like Coventry, you know, who were starting to lose the industries that were sustaining the local economy. And they were highly political as well. So Jerry Damers came out with the song Free Nelson Mandela. And it's a rare example of where a tune actually achieved something politically, because we did get them free.
Yeah, absolutely. And I remember visiting Coventry just slightly after the song, the Ghost Town, had come out. And
yeah.
It was quite accurate.
Aye, absolutely.
So, the Specials.
Thank you.
One of those records that really defines the moment, isn't it? Really?
Absolutely, absolutely. And when Mandela did get free and he came to Wembley, he gave Jerry Dammers a huge hug and told him that he'd actually seen it. And for me, that was actually quite a moving moment because I was active Edinburgh anti-apartheid group, you know, so I knew what it was at the time, and what it meant. And it was just, it was phenomenal to see something that you never thought would happen, because according to the Conservatives and the Tories, I still remember them going about with Hang Mandela badges and they said he was a terrorist. And now he's recognised as one of the people of the 20th century.
Absolutely, yeah.
But according to them, he was a terrorist, But that song was transformative, and I think brought him, Mandela, to attention, or everybody, the whole world, because that's such a jumpy tune, You'd have to be dead not to be able to move your body.
Well, we were in the studio. So.
Yeah, absolutely.
You're listening to Thelma FM, and we're talking to Gordon Munro, councillor for Leith, and we've been going through some of his records. Thelma FM is the Living Memory Association's broadcasting arm, if you like, and we are broadcasting from the Little Shop of Memory at Ocean Terminal. You were just telling me, before we sign off with Gordon here, you were just telling me how you started your record playing yourself, how you got about your equipment and stuff.
Yeah. When I first started working full-time, I knew that I wanted to get myself a record deck, amp and speakers, so I could properly hear the music, because the radiogram that the folks had at home was just, it just played mono, really. Which was all right for Dr Feelgood, because they actually recorded their stuff in mono, but there were some folk that actually did stereo, this newfangled thing. And they were talking about quadraphonic at the time as well. Yeah. But I had to, because you weren't allowed credit, because I was under 21, my dad had to sign to guarantee that if I didn't make the payments to Comet, then he would actually have to step up to the plate. So we went down to Comet New Haven Road and got...
You remember it, yeah.
Yeah, and I've still got that record deck, amp and speakers.
Have you?
Yeah, so I've got my money's worth.
What make was it?
It's a Pioneer deck, Trio amp, and then Solovox speakers, which were actually just Wharfdale in disguise.
God, actually, that's a good setup, wasn't it? That must have put you...
Yeah, it was a good couple of hundred quid at the time, which is, because I still remember my dad saying outside, you better make every payment, son. Quite right and all.
Yeah, and how many records have you got now?
I've got about 300 albums and about the same in singles, And some of them have gone AWOL, The one that has gone AWOL, there's somebody out there that's got it, but it's the very first punk single, The Damned, New Rose. I know, and stuff.
If you're out there somewhere, give it back.
Absolutely. I still miss it, Even the B-side, they went and did the Beatles Help, and did it in under 2 minutes because they were that fast. Brilliant stuff.
Fantastic. Well, big thanks, Gordon. Thanks for coming in.
No, pleasure. Great.
Thank you for listening. I hope you enjoyed this podcast with Gordon. You can find more like it on our website, www.livingmemory.org.uk. Until the next time, take care.